Kyle Reynolds. I'm the senior pastor here. Grateful that you are joining us in worship. Today is an exciting day. Just about an hour ago, our youth left on mission trip, and so they are headed to Fort Worth. 14 students, 4 adults, going to be working with an organization called Be the Neighbor, specifically around immigration. So it's a learning experience as well as a service opportunity. I'm really excited for that. Would invite you to be in prayer for Sydney as she leads that team, and Denise and Bailey and Eric, Pastor Eric, who are going as leaders as well, and then for all of our students throughout this week, that they would encounter God in a new and surprising way, that they would learn, that they would have the ability to serve, and that trip would be a blessing for them. Thank you for those who brought food for the food drive. We do that the first Sunday of every month. If you want to bring something by, of course, later this week, you can do so. Mornings, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, the office is open, and we would love to receive those. It's never too late. Today, we also have a special opportunity. It's a special Sunday where we are celebrating UMCOR. So there are some sheets on the rows where you are, but you can learn a little bit more about that. Pastor Jessica will talk about that later, but it's a giving opportunity, and UMCOR is a great part of who we are as United Methodists. Sometime in the service, if you would take a moment to register your attendance, I'd be grateful. You can do that in the green notebooks. You can also fill out prayer requests there. Drop those in the offering plate when that comes by later, and we would be happy to pray with you in the week to come. I wanted to remind you that the deadline to register to vote for the primary elections in August is the 16th. We know that this is important, and I really appreciate that we're a congregation that takes this seriously, and so I appreciate that reminder. In fact, when we had moved last year, it was while I was making an announcement about it that I realized I needed to change my voter registration. I want to remind you about that. That's an important part of who we are and how we enact our faith. Wanted to let you know, make sure you save the date for August 11th. That's going to be our Kids Day. So whether you have students that are going to come and participate, or there is somebody that you would like to invite to come and participate in it, or you want to come and volunteer, I hope that you'll circle that date. You can go ahead and register now. That registration is live. You can let us know you want to volunteer. And it's a great time to start thinking about who you could invite. This is our sort of one-day alternative to VBS. It's a great family inclusive event, which means that parents and or grandparents or caring adults and students get to do activities together. Also, as we look ahead, we're celebrating our 40th year, and it's not too late for you to share your perspective and your story about the ministry that we've done at St. Paul's together. There's information in the newsletter about how you can do that, just a quick Google form, and we are asking everybody to do that. If you need that link, I would be happy to provide it as well and plug you in with how you can share that information. Friends, today we get a special treat. I'm really grateful that Pastor Howard Johnson is going to be preaching. We are continuing our series called Faithful, in which we're looking at some of the promises of God and a God who is steadfast to fulfill those. It runs in conjunction with our summer reading program as we talk about the promises of God. And so just am incredibly grateful that we have this time to worship, that we have this beautiful day in this beautiful space to gather in. So I want to invite you, as you're able, to stand as we begin to worship. Let's sing this opening song together.
that you've done for me.
Conquered the grave. If you believe that this morning, I invite you to sing this out with us.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Sing it again.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. The grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave, worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the
up a shout of praise this morning because of all he's done. Amen.
Yeah.
shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. No wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. And I'd invite you to join me in a time of prayer. God, we praise you that your love for us exceeds the bounds of our comprehension. To be assured that you seek and search after us no matter what. God, we confess it's often easier for us to accept that you do that for others. And so hard to accept that same love and grace for ourselves. Help us to be able to accept ourselves the way that you do, to see ourselves the way you see us, as precious. God, we find comfort knowing that wherever we go, even and maybe especially when we feel lost, you are always there with us. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, today is our UMCOR Sunday. And so UMCOR is the United Methodist Committee on Relief. We like acronyms in the United Methodist Church. So we call it UMCOR, but that's what it stands for. And it is an organization that shows God's love by responding quickly in times of crisis, including natural disasters. They show up during humanitarian crisis, after tornadoes, hurricanes, and they showed up to my hometown a number of years ago after a devastating flood impacted the entire city and many homes, many businesses, and impacted the water supply for the entire town. Across the denomination, we collect funds for the operation of UMCOR so that when something does happen, 100% of the money that's collected can go directly towards the relief efforts. That includes food, medicine, and much, much more. They work year-round to train so that when a crisis does happen, they can be on the ground immediately wherever that is. We're also able to embody and the compassion of God and be a beacon of hope through our UMCOR donations. As you arrived, perhaps you got one of these envelopes for UMCOR Sunday. We also have some cards that can tell you a little bit more about UMCOR, and you can give by designating that to UMCOR today or by the QR code. I'd like to invite our ushers forward for our offering, and I'd like to invite our kids to join me for Kids Connection. Mr. Gary's at the back of the sanctuary. Kids through sixth grade are invited to join us for a lesson. Thank you.
I invite you to stand and we'll sing our doxology together.
Oh, bless the gifts our hands have brought, and bless the work our hearts have planned. Ours is the faith, the will, the thought. The rest, oh God, is in your hand.
Would you pray with me? Good and holy God, we acknowledge this day most especially the many gifts and blessings that you've given to us. We give you thanks for the resources that you've entrusted to us, for the opportunity that we have to gather in community, to use our gifts, to serve the world, and to make an impact. God, we especially lift up today gratitude for the work that UMCOR does on our behalf and the way they help people rebuild lives after times of crisis. So we ask that you would bless everything that's been given today, that you would multiply it, that you would bless those who have given and those who will receive, that all may experience, even here and now, a taste of your kingdom that is yet to come. This we ask and pray in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Friends, as we continue in worship, I want to invite you to take a few moments to greet one another. If you don't know somebody's name, it's okay to tell them yours and to ask them theirs.
I really like to wait till everybody's done. I'm Howard Johnson. I guess you heard that already. That may or may not have meaning to you, depending on your age. I appreciate Kyle inviting me to preach this morning. I wanted to share with you what I'm sure is, to most people, is probably a pretty familiar passage of Scripture from Luke 15, the first 10 verses. Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to him. And the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. "Which one of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders and rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends, his neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my lost sheep.' Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost.' Just so I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents." God, give us eyes to see and ears to listen to these words. Have you ever lost something, lost a wallet or a purse, something of value, had that experience? I mean, isn't it kind of a universal one that happens to us? This last year, I guess maybe it's 2 years ago now, my grandson Owen was in, we went all the way out, you know, halfway to Fort Scott, out to Heritage Park, to the football fields out there. Seems like halfway to Fort Scott from where I live. Anyway, I live in Shawnee. So went down there, and we're sitting in the stands watching this great, you know, flag football game, having a great time. And I'd been sitting there, sitting way up high so you could see all the action, you know. And a fella stands up in the front row and says, "Is there a Howard Johnson here?" I was like, "I think that's probably me." And so I said, "Yeah." And he said, "Here's your wallet." I'd worn those dumb shorts, you know, that lose the wallet out of the back, and it fell down between the stands and was back down there. And some kid picked it up and brought it over to him. I mean, it was a wonderful moment. I was really like, wow. I didn't even realize I'd lost it. That's the unique thing. A lot of times when we lose stuff, we know it, don't we? Go through that panic. How many of you have lost sheep? I think it's a question I like to ask just in case. I mean, I don't know who all's in attendance. There might be somebody here who, you know, takes care of sheep. But how many times have we heard this passage in Luke about the good shepherd and the lost sheep? I mean, we just sang about it a minute ago, right? How many times have we heard this? And how many stories or books or tales have been told about the lost sheep and the shepherd seeking the lost sheep? They've been described very creatively in detail. The saving of the lost little lamb, the shepherd fighting off dangerous beasts and climbing over rough terrain to find it perched precariously on a ledge or stuck in a thorn bush or injured or sick, doing whatever it takes to retrieve it. I guess we do kind of like to embellish that story. And we do take great comfort in that story. Because when we hear that Jesus loves us, especially when we're in times of trial or are feeling lost, it touches us deeply. But is that really the only message in this passage? Is that the only one that Jesus sought to give? Who's the group that Jesus is really talking to here? Well, if we kind of review and go back to those first couple of verses, we get some clarity about it. The sinners and tax collectors were gathering in again to hear Christ. They're looking for good news. And the Pharisees and scribes were there too. And they were grumbling. They were upset. They were upset with this so-called holy man hanging around with this lowlife, ne'er-do-wells, people who were outcasts from their religious tradition, tax collectors, no less. Now, just to be clear, tax collectors were not loved. I mean, how many of you have deep passion for your IRS agent? Yeah, never know. Actually, I've served a couple of congregations in which there was an IRS person in the group that actually and they were amazingly wonderful, generous people. But tax collectors back in Jesus' day were really closer to extortionists because they bid for their position to be a tax collector so that they pay the most they possibly could pay to the person above them who then also bid for their position. So it's kind of a complicated system, but it was not a popular thing to be a tax collector. So Jesus turns to the scribes and Pharisees and tells them these short parables. And he puts the stories in economic terms for them, which I think is interesting because that may have been the way he thought he could get their attention. "Which of you would not go to find the little lamb that was lost?" he asks. I mean, farming back then is no different than farming now. You can't really afford to lose an animal. It affects your bottom line. It always hurts. And Jesus told these stories hoping to open their eyes and open their hearts. All children are God's sheep. We're all part of God's flock. God, the good shepherd, will always seek the lost ones, even if the church casts them out. Jesus probably seemed like a bit of a wild-eyed, radical, crazy man to those Pharisees and scribes. He was challenging their system, their status quo. He wasn't following the main line of religious thought. He was teaching and hanging around with the unrighteous. How dare he? I have to tell you, it has taken decades, many of which I have lived and served under its name, for the United Methodist Church to finally live up to its motto: open hearts, open minds, open doors. In some ways, for years, we too functioned as those same scribes and Pharisees. We grumbled. And the truth hurts, doesn't it? When we look at all those lost decades, and we'd rather avoid that pain thinking about it sometimes. But Jesus reminds us in this story that we may be the scribes and Pharisees. We may not be quite ready to welcome all of the flock. Often our identity is closer to the 90 and 9 who stayed behind than to Jesus. We aren't the radicals that Jesus was, and really it does. It hurts our feelings to hear it. So who do we identify with in Jesus' parable? The lost sheep? I think at times. I mean, I think the story does not imply what kind of sheep it is or what shape it's in. May not be a pretty little lamb, could be an injured one, a sick one, abused one, tormented, maybe a lamb on drugs or in prison or whose body is tormented and twisted with disease, or maybe one of those sheep that's always just a little bit different. Maybe a different shade of wool. Or do we identify with the 90 and 9 who are left behind safely in the fold? Do you remember that expression? Have you heard that idea? The 99 who are safely in the fold. That is not in Scripture. That's the work of hymn writers. I often wonder what their purpose was. They wrote a hymn saying, just talking about the lost sheep and Jesus going to find the lost one, leaving the 99 in the fold. It's part. I mean, they must have been just trying to make it rhyme or something, or just to fill in the stanza. I don't know, because it has nothing to do with the Scripture. The Scripture actually says they were not left in a fold, but they were, by the way, do you know what a fold is, just to be clear? Oh, the geographically, it's a place that comes down, and shepherds in those days would block off the end so that all those animals that were in the, and the shepherd would be the gate to the fold, and all of them would be safe. But that's not where they were left. They weren't left in a fold. They were left in the wilderness. The shepherd left them in the wilderness and went to find the lost one. So the righteous who are not lost are trusted to be out in the wilderness, not a comfortable fold or pen. The flock, the main body of the church, is still surrounded by wilderness, filled with temptation and danger. All kinds of paths can lead us away from the flock so that we too can become the one that is sought after. But there's no safe place, no security, no guarantee of sinless behavior, only a loving, caring, supportive community, accountable community of sheep who know they need each other. Now, John Wesley's perspective about God's love, relentless, reckless love, was that God's grace reaches out to us, calls us, seeks us, even without our realizing it. And he called it prevenient grace. We can always manage to resist it or ignore it, but it's always still trying to reach us. Luke, in writing this passage, is describing such a God in this parable, a God who promises to seek out the lost. The interesting thing is, once we're found, I think God calls us to a deeper discipleship, not just relaxing and feeling secure in the safety of an accountable community. No nice walls to keep the world out, but loving action, seeking the least, the last, and the lost. Oh, there is peace beyond understanding that goes with us, that feeling that carries us through trial, but there is no room for complacency. Our call is still and always will be to love one another and welcome all, for we really are both the sinner and the saved. The lost one and the righteous 99. Paul, the Apostle Paul himself, actually celebrated a great deal that while he was once the very worst of sinners, Jesus used him to reach others. He never forgot that. He always remembered that lostness that he had and was always still using that to reach other people. But what about you and I today? What about the church today? What about us? Are we sitting comfortably in our usual seat? Now, I don't come to 9 o'clock, so I can't check. We're sitting there feeling secure. Do we remember that we are still in the wilderness? That there are still lost ones around us? Maybe even amongst us? And maybe even us that God is seeking? Can we rejoice with the angels over the ones that are found, opening our arms to receive them into the flock, no matter what they look like or who they are? Are we standing around shaking our heads and grumbling like the scribes and Pharisees, thinking we're just a little bit better than all those others, those different ones? How many times have we heard this story? How often we forget that Jesus is talking to us, the church today? Do we remember what it's like to be lost? I think it was around 1976. Yeah, I know, it's a while back. You all remember that? I mean, there's probably a few of you who could raise your hand. Lois and I were serving at Henderson Settlement in Frakes, Kentucky, which is 18 miles from the nearest town of 3,000 in southeast Kentucky. Rural, to say the least. And our friend Chuck, he lived downstairs, we lived upstairs, had started a little adventure in which he bought a brand new, I think it was a 74, maybe it was a 75, Ford Econoline van that was just completely empty, and he was building it out so that he could camp and stuff in it. Great, great fun, great process. It wasn't anything really fancy. Don't paint too clear a picture of, like, fancy stuff, okay? It was very simple, practical. This is a person who'd spent 3 years in overseas in Fiji Islands teaching. So very functional, everything was functional, and he had it all ready, and we said, okay, in 1976, we had the chance for us all to go camping together. We liked to camp. We had a tent. He had his van. So we said, let's go to the Great Smoky Mountains on Memorial Day. Yeah, we did. And actually, we had a pretty good time. I think we got the last campground in Cades Cove, and we had a great time in our camping experience, and everything was going well, and we enjoyed our time. And then we said, well, let's head home. And traffic was unbelievable. Of course, crowds of people everywhere. We're not in any hurry to get back. It's about three and a half hours to get back. Let's not take the interstate. Let's get out our map. Are you familiar with maps? I don't mean Google Maps. I mean, you know, paper ones. We had those ones we got from State Farm, you know, that had every state. So if you actually wanted to see where you were, you had to have a magnifying glass. But so we got out our map, and we said, oh, look, we could take this highway, and instead of that goes across the interstate, and we take the back way home. Yeah, it sounds like a great plan. And we started out. Did I mention there's no cell phones? Did I mention there's no Siri? There's no GPS? And we're heading out just fine. Everything's going good. And there's actually several people that are on the road with us. We're kind of encouraged by that. And we're driving along, and everything's good. And we come to a sign that says detour, like this. And all of us dutifully, and a whole row of cars, dutifully follow the detour. And we're going along. And then maybe another car would turn off here, a car would turn off there. We traveled and traveled. We didn't see any more signs. We stayed behind this car that we'd been following for 15 minutes, maybe more. We're driving along, we're going just fine, and we round this little hillside following it, and it turns into his driveway. And we round the hill, and suddenly we're on a gravel road. Oh, we're not scared of gravel roads. I mentioned we lived in rural southeast Kentucky, which is mostly gravel roads and mountainous roads. And so we say, oh, whatever happened to the detour? Well, we'd been busily talking and carrying on. It's hard to blame us. We're drinking iced tea and lemonade and having a wonderful time and reminiscing about our time together. And as we drive along, we realize this thing is winding back up into what appears to be kind of a mountain. And it could be a dead end up in there. We don't know. So as we're going, we said, well, what do you think? And right before we started to wind back up into that mountain, here was this big home on the left side of the road with a gigantic family gathering. They were having a Memorial Day celebration. It was awesome. It looked like they were having a lot of fun. They had volleyball nets and all sorts of games. They were all outside. And we kind of pulled up to stop, and a fella comes running over and says, hey, you okay? What do you need? He says, well, we're just wondering. I mean, Chuck asked him, if we follow this on up, will this take us over the mountain and get us to the highway to get home? He asked where we're going, and we told him, and he said, yeah, it actually will. It's going to be, it's a mountain road. I said, yeah, we're okay with that. And so he says, just go all the way over. When you get to the top, you get way up to the top, and then you wind all the way down. And when you get to the bottom, there's a stop sign. Take a right. Awesome. Thank you so much for taking time from your party. And we headed up the hill. And we hadn't gone real far before kind of the lemonade and the iced tea sort of began to create an awareness, especially amongst Chuck and I guess, were the prime ones. I said to Chuck, Chuck, maybe as we're winding up this gravel road through the woods, maybe we could just kind of pull over for a second, and take care of matters. We opened up the door. I jumped out, and he got out. And then it was like, wait a minute. We hear a car on the gravel. Oh, great. Well, we jump back in. Okay. Chuck, being an experienced mountain driver in Southeast Kentucky, we were like, okay, let's get a move on this time. Let's get up a little farther. Let's get way ahead of this, and then we'll pull over again. So he goes at a fairly high, acceptable to us at the time, pace. I don't know if it'd be acceptable now. Brought us up the hill, taking us farther and farther, and we just jumped out again. And the gravel noise was even closer. It was like, uh-oh. Okay, let's get back in. So he really sped up this time. We sped farther up the hill, got going, and finally, we got up to the top, and there was a great big wide place, and he pulled over just as a little red Volkswagen Bug came up behind us honking. This is quite a journey. And out jumps the man from the house. We're like, whoa. And he says, no, turn left. Turn left. That story has always stuck with me after all these years. And it makes me ask myself this question, and I hope it may cause you to think of this question. How far would you go to help someone who is lost? Amen.
Friends, one of the things that I love about our celebration of this communion meal each week is that it reminds us not only of the extent and the length to which God is willing to go through Christ that we might be found, but it also reminds us that wherever we are, whether that be in the wilderness among the flock, whether that be the grumbling scribes and Pharisees, whether that be lost, perhaps in a way that is known to other people and perhaps in a way that is not. If we feel ourselves to be found and perhaps resting too far on our laurels or growing deeper in our faith, the promise of this meal is that Jesus invites each one of us to come and to receive, to be strengthened, to be found, to experience a bit of himself. And so I would invite you in whatever way is comfortable to pray with me as we bless this meal and prepare to receive this gift of Holy Communion. God, we know that it is a good and a right and a joyful thing for us always and everywhere to give our thanks and praise to you. for you formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. And even when our love failed and we turned away, your love has always remained steadfast. You spoke to us through the prophets, called us out of captivity, and made covenant to be our God. And so with your people here on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name this day and give thanks for your holy and mighty works. Holy are you, Lord God, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By your Spirit, you anointed him to preach good news to the poor and to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who were oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. He healed the sick and fed the hungry and ate with sinners. It was by the baptism of his living, dying, and resurrection that you gave birth to your church, made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit, and promised to be with us always by the power of your Holy Spirit. We remember on that night that Jesus would be betrayed. He gathered with his disciples in an upper room. God, he gave thanks to you. He took a loaf of bread and he broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Each time you eat it, do so in remembrance of me." Likewise, when the supper was over, he took a cup. He gave thanks to you, God. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, do so in remembrance of me." So, Lord God, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Christ Jesus, we offer ourselves as a holy and a living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. We ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on these gifts of bread and juice and on each one of us gathered here. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we may be the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. It is through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit, that we pray all honor and glory be yours, Almighty God, now and forevermore. We ask that you would hear us as we join our voices praying together as Jesus taught, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Friends, we who are many are made one because we all share the same body, the same gift of Christ. This cup over which we give thanks and which we share in is a sharing in the salvation offered through him. I would invite those who are helping to serve communion to come forward. And as they do come forward, I want to remind you that ours is an open table, which means that all are welcome to come and receive. You need not be one who considers yourself found or have found all the meaning of communion. You simply need to want to receive the grace of God as it's offered in this meal. You can spend some time reflecting. You can light some candles. But come and receive this gift and trust that God meets you in grace right where you are through this meal.
Uncontained, your love is a fire burning bright for me. It's not just a spark, it's not just a flame. Your love is a light that all the world will see. All the world will Don't give your heart in pieces. You don't hide yourself to Jesus. You don't give and you don't give your heart in pieces. You don't hide yourself to Jesus. Your love's not fractured. It's not a troubled mind. It isn't anxious. It's not the restless kind. Your love's not passive. It's never disengaged. It's always present and hangs on every word we say. Love keeps its promises. It keeps its word. It honors what's sacred, 'cause its vows are good. Your love's not broken, it's not insecure. Your love's not selfish, your love is pure. And you don't give your heart in pieces. Don't hide yourself to Jesus. You don't give. You don't give your heart in pieces. And you don't hide yourself to Jesus.
Pray with me. Good and holy God, what a gift it is to be reminded of the countless ways that you give your love to us. We give you thanks especially for this holy mystery in which you make yourself known to us. When we leave this time of worship, God, may we be certain that we've had an encounter with you. May we be strengthened by this bread and this juice sent forth to serve and to love the world that you care so deeply about. All this we ask and pray in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Friends, would you stand and join us in our closing song?
Let's put our hands together.
My world was shaking, my heart was broken, my hope was fading, my walls closing in, but now I'm singing, look how he lifted me. My life is sinking, my days are numbered, the waves are crashing, the waves are coming in, but hallelujah, look how he lifted me. Look how you see, look how he lifted me. back into dancing. Keep up jumping into a shout again. Oh, hallelujah. Look how we lifted me. He rolled my sorrow away at Calvary. He rose in triumph over the enemy. Oh, hallelujah. Look how we lifted me. Let's lift it up. Look how he lifted me. His grace and mercy is my testimony for every victory. I've got a song to sing. Look how he lifted me. Your love came down, your love came down. When nothing else could help, your love came down and lifted me. When nothing else could help, your love came down, your love came down. When nothing else could help, your love came down and lifted me. Look how he lifted me. Let's put our hands together.
His grace and mercy
is my testimony for every victory. I've got a song to sing. Oh, look how he lifted me. His grace and mercy is my testimony for every victory. I've got a song.
Thank you. That was good. Fun. So are you feeling lost? Got good news. God will seek you out. Sometimes even when you're trying to run away from God, God will catch up with you. Because God loves you. As you leave this place, remember you're going back out into the world. Go and be those who understand what it means to be loved. And look at those people who need to be loved and love them. Amen.